Welcome back to the...
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again.
Today's video, we are back on the Klein, and you can tell, doggies, it's come a long ways, man. It's bright, it's flashy, it shows off this awesome paint job that, you know, comes with and they're known for, this one specifically being McCoy Orange. So one of the things I did mention, if you haven't seen part one, you should go back and check that out. And I do want to take the time, thank you for watching, but do please subscribe, it helps my small channel grow, try and hit that 1,000 as fast as I can. Put some more money back into this channel, because I originally, if you haven't seen part one, I did buy this bike back in January 18th actually. So it's been a long time coming. It's a lot of work to find all this stuff on a budget. It's a lot of searching. But we persevered and we came through. As I mentioned, this bike caught a little flack for going OTB over the bars because of the suspension setup here and the unified rear triangle, they call it. But I did a lot of changes to it. Actually, I kind of went back and looked at the geometry too. Something I had noticed when I got the bike, and actually I had thought in part one, somebody had previously changed the stem and handlebars. Actually, I have them right here. And what they actually were Bontrager race crowbars on a Bontrager stem, and that was actually stock for that bike. So it's a pretty good setup. What I'm guessing is that they're not very wide. I think it's gonna be a problem having something with a small sweep on it, and there's no, you know, you have the angle backwards, but there's no real width to it to give yourself somewhat more ability to, you know, if you did hit a bad descent, which, like I said in part one, this bike isn't meant for hardcore mountain biking. I don't care what anybody says. It's a single track crushing machine, if you ask me. And that's one place I did want to start. We did put wider handlebars on it. They are much wider, but they're also thicker too. The ones I just showed you were 28.6 diameter. These are 31.8. That actually makes a big difference in comfort, but also ability to like control yourself. It's, especially on a bike as nimble as this, if you ask me, it's a must have. We also changed the stem. It had 130 degree or 25, maybe 125 millimeter, something big, maybe 120. I'll have to measure it. But the stem that was on there is very big. This is a very cool profile design. As you can see, there's no actual bolts showing on the front. I love that. That's very sleek. Goes along with the kind of my theme to this whole build here. You got the bolts hanging underneath here. But we went with a 110, bring it back in, something a little more normal. There's really literally no reason for you to be hanging over the handlebars on a bike that might throw you over the handlebars. So, another thing I did change to address that issue, I didn't want to forget, so I'm going to step out of my little box here. The carbon seat post, this has a 20 millimeter setback. The one we had previously, this one was just a zero offset, as you can see. No offset in between, and on the back there's a slight offset. To me, again, if you did find yourself in position or you want to stay comfortable in the descents, you should have a slight setback. Stem should be brought in. And that was just the start of it, and I think it paid off great. Also, you know, aluminum seat post, this is super heavy. This saddle, it's cool, WTB, like, you know, for older mountain bikes, I guess I would say it worked back in the day, but as you can see, it's not very, It says comfort zone, but it doesn't look very comfortable. So we got a newer giant Kinect on top of there, and that's an upright position saddle, so it's like a medium level. It's not like their racier one, but it's not their big super plush one that will kind of rub you up like something like this. So that was a big change that we had made there. Another thing, like I was saying on the stem though, this the degree here was only 6 degrees stock, and we went up to, I believe, yes, 16 degree. So gives you a little bit, you know, you're gonna be riding more upright, gives you your stem meeting you up there a little more upright. These sweeps are gonna be just as even on the bars as well. So overall, I think we did a very good job on fighting that. Again, I mentioned in part one, not only does all of this combo, you know, like combo, video game style. All right, so sorry for that. The interruption was sponsored by Veloce's moment in the camera. He must always have, or else he'll keep attacking me. So like I was saying, changing that angle on the stem here, that was a very big part of doing that. Comboed it all together. And then to make it even better, combat the over the bars even more. This fork has already been upgraded. Millimeter SID, RockShox SID, Hydrocoil. This is an air with oil in it. Good setup. A lot of travel. You get a lot more ability to adjust your setup with the air setup, and the rear shock has also been air. Again, I covered this in part one, but like this is very, you know, purpose built here. And I think it really paid off. It doesn't just look awesome. I just really couldn't stand all the criticism the bike was getting. Because in the used bike world, man, these are some real, I mean, they're not hidden bike gems because everybody knows about them, but they're sought. They're sought after and people love them. And I mean, if this was the medium, this would be mine forever. So one day I'll find one, but this one is large and we end up losing a full pound overall. Let's get back into the drivetrain. As you can see on the back of the handlebars here, because this thing won't stay straight, we have changed to SRAM X9 shifters. These are ball bearing shifters. These are the later generation of the 10 speed. And this is 10 by 2 speed, of course. We kept our crankset set up here all the same as it was in part one. But these shifters are incredible. If you had some hydraulic disc brakes or something like that, they have a 1-bolt system. It's incredibly light. I paired this to the Avid. These are AD01 or 1.0 levers. These are a pair to the Avid 2.0s I was talking about in part one. Previously we had Dior brakes, and those are actually pretty nice. Those are fairly new, about the same age as these, but they ended up weighing more. And surprisingly, when I put a pair of these on just to see how they felt spring pressure wise, these Avids had very good spring pressure. The Diors, I mean, I'm used to them for cyclocross bikes, so I've always thought they were good, but these were far more impressive, so we stuck with them. Also, they're a little bit lighter, helped us shed some weight. I went ahead and upgraded the pads too. I have some newer Tektro pads on the front and some Jagwire ones first. They're a little bit bigger with some like more aggressive tread for wet and stuff like that on the back. As I mentioned, our crank has the 2X conversion. We got a Salsa chain guard on here. I actually ended up pulling this whole thing off. It was so filthy. It's incredible that these chain rings are actually pretty much brand new, because I don't understand how they got so dirty. It blows my mind sometimes how I get some of these bikes. So I popped this whole crank off. I ended up taking it all apart, cleaning everything, and then, you know, found out we actually got a good setup here. Looks like these are already 9 N10s. There's a lot of rings that like FSA, Intributive, and all these companies they make. So this is the 9 or 10 speed rings that you can run. No rubbage or anything. Runs great on this setup with a brand new SRAM X9 band type high pull clamp. It fits well on this bike because it's supposed to be like a cyclocross top bowl or mountain bike hardtail. They usually have the cable running up here and down, so it pulls from the top. This one, the cable's running underneath and it pulls from the bottom. Good trick to know though on this SRAM 10 speed setups, all of their mountain bike front derailleurs, they're dual pull type. So I was actually able to keep the high clamp that I need for this style suspension and use it on the bottom pull. So that's a really neat trick. I was very pleased with that. And man, it's so much nicer setting up this new stuff than having to set up all this old stuff. And I mean, even with, I went on the back here, you could see that is a big boy. That's a 1136 we have on the back there. That's actually the maximum cassette we could run. And I mean, honestly, this is a 3222 1136. You really don't need that much bigger than that. If you really were doing like insane climbing, then I would say, or just long, long gravel roads, maybe you're bike packing, who knows, go 1X. That's personally not my thing. I would keep it the way it is now. I mean, 22, 36, that's a big climbing setup. So very pleased with that cassette. This is a budget one I got off of Amazon. I'll have links to all of this stuff in the description as well. And we paired that off with this Ram X9, again, newer generation rear derailleur. This has like a carbon P cage, they call it pulley cage. So that's neat to see the carbon fiber there. Very high performance, super lightweight. I was very pleased with setting this up again too. Between the shifters and the rear derailleur and the front derailleur, that entire group set, all of X9, I've had X7, I've had X5, I've had X3, but man, the X9 is really nice stuff. They even go up to XO, which is like full carbon fiber shifters and everything. This was my budget build. Had to buy it in bits and pieces, and I'm so happy with how it came out. I mean, the bike looks gorgeous, but it rides gorgeous. And I mean, like, shifting and everything is just such a big important on how it, you know, the feel, and you know, it's a big thing on biking. So to get all of this to flow together on a budget, I mean, I'm just so pleased with the bike. We went ahead and threw some cool little nylon pedals on here, nothing super serious, but some little removable pins on here. They're great for some medium level mountain biking. I wouldn't do hard drops, you would definitely break these. But for on a budget, everyday use, these are nice and they have removable pins on them as well. Did some cool things, like threw a little carbon fiber spacer on there to complement, you know, the little bits of carbon we got flowing everywhere. And that would pretty much top the whole build off, guys. Of course, we always do the gold chain mafia. That's how we roll. One neat thing I did do, I like to do when I get the opportunity. These are, and actually I bought these for the first time ever off of Amazon in a kit. This is a set of Jagwire brake cables in yellow I got to go with, you know, the flow of the yellow on the top. And I got the orange cables to go with the outside. And they come in the kits and they come with all of the little ends. And they come with the little crimp spots that you got to put on here to the cable. The cable ends you got to crimp on over here. So think about that. Again, link in the description. Compliments the bike great. I love how it turned out. It's if I could keep it, I'd just hang it up because it's such a cool thing to look at. And that pretty much will cover it. Oh yeah, of course the grips, these are just some Amazon specials I got. But the one good thing is that they're lock-on on both sides. So if you do get some budget grips, be sure to get some double lock-ons. And I think these were like 10 bucks or something. So can't be any happier with the way it is. I got a little lucky, you know, as I mentioned part one with the new tires and the rear shock already being upgraded. That is air as well, as I mentioned, and that's it. So I hope you guys have been enjoying it. Hold on 1 second, actually I'll show you a secret new project. If you made it this far, this is for the real OGs, because I know that not that many people watch this far. This is a very cool Marin steel frame that I got here. Yeah, you should check it out. Don't forget to like and subscribe, guys. Thanks for watching again. Have a good day. Bye.